Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received apologies from David Torrance for today's meeting and James Dornan will be substituting for him. James joins us online, as does Tess White. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private today. Are members agreed?
Yes.
We're agreed, thank you. And the next item on our agenda is consideration of a negative instrument, and that instrument is Feed Additives Authorisation Scotland Regulations 2022. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 25th of October and they made no recommendations. So the purpose of this instrument is to implement the decision made by the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport in relation to 11 feed additives, authorising 5 new feed additives for placing on the market and use in Scotland, and renewing, modifying and re-evaluating or extending the authorisation for 6 others. The instrument also includes transitional arrangements for the 3 existing feed additives authorisations, and no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Would any members like to comment on this instrument? Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just that I am going to be continued to be interested in feed additives and any legislation like this that comes forward, because I think it's really important that we know what we're consuming. And when we hear about novel foods and we hear about what's happening in other countries as far as trade and issues in my research of hormones and other chemicals that are being added to products that might end up in our food supply chain. And because of our informal discussion with Food Standards Scotland last week, I just want to basically put on record that this is something that is really important and we should pay attention to.
Thank you, Emma. I expect no less from you. I know you've got a long-standing interest in this area. Any other comments? No, I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No, we're all in agreement then. We'll move on to our next agenda item. The next item on our agenda is further consideration of the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And we've got 2 evidence sessions today. The first evidence session will focus on the bill as it relates to the future of integrated health and care services, including community health, prevention, local services, rural services and transfer of functions. And I'll welcome those who are joining us in person. First, we've got Nick Morris, the Chair of NHS Board of Chief Executives and Chairs, Alison White, the Convener of Social Work Scotland, and Dr Chris Williams, the Joint Chair of the Royal College of General Practitioners Scotland. And we've got 2 colleagues joining us online. We've got Patricia Cassidy, Chief Officer for Falkirk Health Social Care Scotland Chief Officers, and Alison Keir, the Professional Practice Lead for the Royal College of Occupational Therapists. So welcome to you all. I suppose I am asking, starting things off by asking you your general views on whether the National Care Service Bill, as presented, this framework bill, has the potential to improve integration of services. I mean, one of the things that's been put to us in a lot of the submissions from, I suppose, service users is, I'll actually quote one, we've got an unpaid carer said, there's a lack of connection between health boards, councils, social care and public health, and no joined up thinking. And that's coming from somebody that's using the services. So I guess that's our starting point, to look at the gaps and see if this bill provides the framework at the very least for perhaps better integration. So I'll maybe go around each one of you. Just a note that we won't be able to go around each one of you for every question, but convener's prerogative, I'll allow everyone to answer my question. And then my colleagues will actually direct questions. A note for those that are joining us online, if I don't come to you in the first instance, but you want to add anything, you've got the provision of the chat box online. You can just let me know that you want to come in. Otherwise, if you're in the room, just raise your hand and I'll come to you. So if I maybe go round everyone in the order in which I introduced you, and I'll go to Nick Morris first of all.
Okay. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I think there's lots to be said that's positive about the development of the NCS in the sense of it's bringing stakeholders together, the voice of service users more clearly amplified about their experiences of health and social care. Much of that work is understood at local level, we believe. There's significant work going on to engage with stakeholders at local level about their perceptions of integration, their experiences of joint work within social services, social care systems and health. And there are many things to learn from. Our main concern at the moment is that the focus of the bill is forcing people to consider issues of structure and the consequences of structure, some of which are very hard to interpret because of the evidence that's available within the bill. As a framework bill, it doesn't provide much detail. And at this point in time of our system pressures response in both social care and health, we have to be careful about the distraction that provides to us, the one we need to provide significant leadership to providing a response to those system pressures at the moment. Social care and care services are going through a significant challenge at the moment in terms of recruitment, workforce, etc. I think it's right that the NCS should be looking at issues of equity, of things like fair work, improving their career progression opportunities. I think there's potentially a lot to be said for the development of integrated training and development programmes between health and social care practitioners, which supports the integration in the long term. But at this point in time, we need to do a lot of work to make sure that those staff on the ground are actually providing resilient care to the clients and also are resilient within themselves. And at this point in time, that's not the case. Our social care services are in significant stress, and so are our health and community services too. So I think we welcome the general position of the bill and where it wishes to take things. I think we would support the integration of health and social care. Certainly at local level, I have concerns about the fragmentation that might occur with some of the structures suggested through care boards. And also, we don't know yet, but how the First Minister might structure departments might be a concern for us as well in terms of fragmentation rather than integration. But we support the general tone of moving towards integration at team levels, development of MDTs. We're not quite sure the bill hits the nail on the head at this point in time.
And I'll come to Alison White.
Thank you, Chair. There's much in what Nick has highlighted that we would be echoing in terms of some of the particular challenges, I think, in social work, social care at this point in time, and around the fact that this level of change at the time, that there's this experience that of challenges in recruitment, challenges in retention, the fact that we've gone through a pandemic and that the challenges that we have around a workforce that is on its knees in places, certainly particularly in the care sector around this, and the cost of living crisis that is significantly impacting on frontline care staff. And again, would echo that there's much in the bill that we are really supportive of in terms of the opportunity, I think, for one of the first times for there to be a really strong conversation about social work and social care and what that means and how it fits in. And the importance, I think, of those roles. I think, having just followed an NHS colleague, there's been far too much of a focus, I think, on what's right for the NHS and how we deal with that. But if we are looking at a whole system approach, it's a real opportunity for us to focus and highlight some of the impacts that we have in social work and social care. I'm not sure the bill actually addresses the issues of integration clearly enough. I think when we're looking at employment legislation, I think when we're looking at what that might mean, although I'm here as Social Work Scotland, my day job, I'm a chief officer of a health and social care partnership, IJB, so have that integrated service. And there's something about that joint role that I have that enables me the managerial strategic oversight of both health and social work services, that it's difficult to know how that will move forward and embed with the bill, with staffing arrangements being different, the chief officer or chief executive role sitting in NCS rather than having that in reach into NHS services and what that looks like. So there's a real danger that actually in the short term, certainly, that integration is jeopardised as part of this process. But I do think that one of the aspects that the bill gives in terms of that real sense of co-design and how we have those conversations and what we need to do around making sure that we get that strong voice for people who use the services, because I think you're right, people do get a sense of a disconnect between some elements of the service, not all of the time, but I think there is some disconnect. But I'm not sure the bill addresses those disconnect areas, unfortunately, but I think if we can use the co-design process really effectively to get that strength of voice, both from people who use services and from people who deliver services, I think there's an opportunity for us to shape something that allows the development that we're looking for in terms of integrated services.
That's really helpful, because I mean, the co-design is going to inform the secondary legislation, which should address the issues of detail that you have mentioned so far. But I guess that you're behind the idea of co-design. So, but the co-design has to be meaningful.
Yep. And certainly Social Work Scotland's perspective is that the co-design should come before the legislation rather than after the legislation as well. So certainly Social Work Scotland has had a strong position that we're strongly behind the development of a national care service, the strengthening of all of the rights-based approaches that are there, the strengthening of staff development and how we support staff in meaningful employment. But we feel that that co-design process and that development of how that service looks should take place prior to the development of legislation rather than after this development.
I'll come to Dr. Chris Williams.
Thank you. RCGP Scotland firstly recognise that we have made substantial progress in Scotland in terms of integration of health and social care. And during the last several years, there have been some very different cultures that have had to meet and reconcile. So we absolutely don't want to neglect social care. We do need resource going in that direction. We do need governance arrangements that make sense. The Feely report certainly recognised that there's different governance models across Scotland in different parts, including the lead agency sort of model in Highland. We at the same time as we've tried to think about the way forward here in primary care, we've undergone a substantial programme of primary care reform in terms of the new GMS contract, and that work is still unfinished. There is still a lot of distance to go, I think, before our primary care services are looking and feeling the modernised way that we intend. General practice has had a historical connection to health boards in terms of how we are governed and managed, and we wouldn't want this legislation disrupt that. Currently, we see assurance that that's not happening, but again, beyond the legislation, there's a substantial amount of reform that we can't, I suppose, yet foresee how all of how this co-design process will play out. So one of the most substantial aspects of the bill, I suppose, then is the information sharing aspects. I've had discussions elsewhere with members of this committee around about this desire for people not to be repeating their story, for parts of the system to see aspects of other parts of the system. And I think that while the legislation can do something about that, there's a larger body of work round about the cultural side of things across the health and care parts of our workforce, and also in the investment in information technology infrastructure. I think we continually underestimate the role played by things that we take for granted in other aspects of life, when we're accessing banking, for example, through snazzy apps, when we're able to do other sort of online transactions and things. We've still got quite a good way to go in Scotland for that. So the national data strategy as well, I think that's going to be helpful. But I look forward to seeing what this legislation can do.
Thank you. And I'll go online to our colleagues there. Patricia Cassidy.
I'm representing Health and Social Care Scotland and concur with a lot of the earlier comments. We welcome the introduction of the bill and in particular the principles of the bill, and are keen to realise the opportunities that the framework in the bill offers to become a much more integrated system, to have that person-centred focus. The bill will allow, and potentially the new Community Health and Social Care Boards, set the tone and culture for the staff that work to deliver the outcomes in the organisation, supporting and facilitating that culture of co-production and innovation. We need to learn from the current experience and evidence from the Integration Joint Boards and the variation that there has been across the system. Also, the challenges of bringing together two groups of staff coming from two organisational cultures into a new organisational culture, the challenge of creating that with staff coming from those organisations. So there's an opportunity to create a new cultural organisation that has at its heart that person-centred approach and is really at its heart listening, working with our communities to shape and influence the shape of our services. The partnership, the current partnerships, the principal partners are the NHS and the local authorities, but the Integration Joint Board's partnerships are much more than that, and that's set within the legislation in terms of the representation and involvement of our communities, our carers and our service users. And it's really important that we build on the strengths that we've developed in integration and not disintegrate some of the existing strong relationships that there are. And some of the most interesting innovations have been and have come from those partnerships of several of the local third sector voluntary organisation communities of interest to develop new services. So it's really important that the framework takes account of that and provides an opportunity for a new cultural organisation, which is a broader partnership than perhaps the constituent parts, absolutely with the communities at its heart, but also learning from some of the strengths. I think one of the tensions in the bill and the difficulties is reducing variation across Scotland, but not at the cost of local responsiveness. Some of the real strengths have been at the strategic planning group level, the partnership groups, the links to community planning partnerships, and the ability to flex across the system where there are transfers of care, but also with some of the infrastructure support that, for example, leisure and cultural services in the local authority, housing services, primary care and the health board, that we need to be really careful that we don't risk some of the existing connections that there are and look to how we can reduce, improve our IT systems, the way we handle and transfer and use data, the way we interact with people on several fronts. They may see five or six different professionals. We need to have one multidisciplinary team approach, one shared information that person potentially holds and shares with us. So there's a lot of scope for improvement, but it must be sensitive and guided by those good conversations with the people who use our services, or not forgetting prevention. How do we get in earlier and realise some of the benefits that we can have in terms of prevention? Thank you.
Thank you, Patricia. And you mentioned quite a lot of things that I think my colleagues want to ask specific questions on. And I'll come to Alison Keir before I move on to questions from Paul O'Kane. Alison.
Thank you. Good morning, committee. I'm here today to represent the Royal College of Occupational Therapists, and we commend the ethos of the bill, whereby there's a shift to early intervention and prevention. However, it's not clear how this will be resourced, measured or achieved. So we feel that the bill lacks detail around how we know when we've achieved what we want to achieve. We also have concerns around the use of the word care. And we think that this requires greater clarity, because care means different things to different people. So for a huge proportion of our population, care is being looked after. But actually, is it really care that we mean, or is it support? Because actually, if we want to move to a model of earlier intervention and prevention, are we supporting people to self-manage and live their best lives? Or are we still in a model where we look after people? So are we doing for people, or does the National Care Service in the future want us to do with people, which is where we would want to get to? But I think the title confuses that and changes expectations. There's also some lack of clarity around, so if we look at the purpose being to improve the quality and consistency of social work and social care services in Scotland, as stated in the policy memorandum, that doesn't describe all of what we're aspiring to with the National Care Service. So absolutely, we look to improve and grow our fabulous social work and social care services, but what about our community health colleagues? So if we're looking to improve quality and consistency, it's wider than social work and social care, and it should improve and include community health. And that takes us to a further lack of detail in the bill, whereas community health is a sweeping statement. We can make assumptions around what is defined as community health. There is no definition anywhere. And until we have clarity and definition, we risk making assumptions that could be faulty, but we require some further clarity around that. We also need to think about things like eligibility criteria. So at the moment, we are moving towards a model that is changing if we achieve what we want to achieve through the National Care Service. But eligibility criteria is the gatekeeper to services. Unless we think more widely about how we support people access services, we won't achieve this aspiration. We need to think about how we commission and what we want from that. Is that about outputs or is that about outcomes for people? And how we get to a point that actually we're working in an outcomes-focused way to support people.
I'm going to stop you there, Alison, because there are specific questions coming your way on all the aspects you mentioned, and I really was wanting a broad overview about the bill. So sorry to stop you off mid-flow, but we have a number of questions. Paul Kane.
Thanks, Convener. And just I have two questions, if that's possible, but they'll be directed to individual panellists. Can I just begin with Patricia's comments? I'm just looking for a wee bit more clarity, I think, in terms of where chief officers are on a number of these issues. In many of the submissions we've had from local authorities, IGBs and health and social care partnerships, there has been concern, I think it's fair to say, expressed about what disruption to services will do in terms of integration. I would quote Angus HSEP saying that significant work has already gone into the establishment of IGBs, and actually a feeling that a National Care Service could take away the focus on integration and continual improvement. East Lothian said it would be damaging and counterproductive to restructure services again less than 8 years since the integration of health and social care. So are chief officers of the view that there does have to be structural change to these care boards, or is there a sense that there's not enough detail in the bill to make a judgment about whether we should move to that and what that would look like?
Okay, thank you. We are very mindful of the amount of time it has taken to achieve integration over the last 7-8 years. And are mindful of the risk that further structural change may bring. A number of contributors have mentioned the workforce challenges, and we'd be really concerned that there are some elements that we need to tackle quite quickly in terms of securing and retaining a well-qualified, high-quality workforce, and some of the challenges that we've had that are well rehearsed post-COVID in terms of recruitment and retention across the sector. Is bearing in mind the cost and potential benefits as they're perceived from further structural change, if indeed that is what is decided. There isn't a lot of detail in the bill framework as it stands. I think I've already mentioned that we'd be quite concerned about potentially losing some of the integration and some of the positive relationships and benefits that have been realised within a number of our partnerships. For example, the inclusion or not of children's services, justice services. Some of our well-developed partnerships already have those. Majority of our chief officers felt that that should be within the new structure. However, that's not unanimous. There are other partnerships that are not of that view. So there is variation amongst the chief officers. But in terms of having come through the structural change, there are potential benefits in terms of us being freed, if you like, from some of the bureaucratic demands that we have across the system in the current arrangements, reporting into the council, the NHS board, as well as the integration joint board, and the amount of occasionally duplication of effort that does require, which takes away resource and time from actually delivering the day job, which is, you know, the leadership around integration. There have been tremendous opportunities, particularly with the focus on strategic planning groups and the involvement and links with community planning, to really enrich the way that we deliver service to be responsive to local need. We have and we're required to have strategic needs assessments down to locality level, and those help us with our planning and our targeting of resources. So it's about trying to establish how we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, if you like, and actually take the strengths of the current systems into the opportunities of potentially having an organisation that is planning and managing integrated multidisciplinary teams that are working at that locality level with the benefit of a national infrastructure and an organisational culture that is consistent and is about that absolute ethos and the principles that are held within the bill.
Thank you. Thank you. I wonder if I can move to Alison White in terms of... I appreciate Alison's here as Social Work Scotland, so I might not ask her to necessarily reflect as a chief officer, but I wonder if I can ask about Social Work Scotland's view at the moment. Social Work Scotland obviously have called for a pause in terms of the legislative process. Now, is that about... what you said in terms of your comments about co-design, that there should have been a process of co-design prior to getting to this point, rather than a co-design in the secondary legislation? And just anything else you'd want to add about how Social Work Scotland arrived at that position?
Yeah, certainly. Thank you. And I suppose slightly touching on your first question to Patricia as well in terms of that, I think at times disruption can be good. And Social Work Scotland is not suggesting that where we are at the moment is where we need to be. I think there is a real sense from Social Work Scotland that things do need to change, that we really do need to strengthen the social work profession and how we respond and deal with social care and how we do that in an integrated structure. So there's a strong commitment around that. But I think there is a sense that that level of disruption at the moment, particularly at the point where we're going through one of the worst crises in terms of workforce, the challenges that we're seeing within our hospital settings, the level of delayed discharges, some of the challenges with the designs and delivery programmes that we already have across the wider social work setting in terms of the promise and the aspirations for justice services and amongst that, the workforce pressures that we're having at this point in time and the cost of living crisis that we're experiencing that's having an impact both on the people that we support, on our staff team, particularly some of our lowest paid staff, but also in terms of the budget that we have available to us at the moment, it feels as though there is a lot of disruption already going on. I think for us, we have a strong commitment, and I think the ethos and values that we're seeing in the National Care Service Bill, there's nothing that we would want to be taking away from. All of the aspects that we see within that we would be wholeheartedly supportive of, but we do feel that we need to be doing that design process and looking at how we make those shifts collaboratively rather than having that framework legislation in place. I think certainly when we'd looked across the piece, it was felt that there were some challenges to the framework type of legislation, but we do feel that meaningful co-design process, and I think the challenge for us within the timeframes that are being set out within the current legislation, if I take you back to all of the disruption that we're experiencing in the system at the moment, for Social Work Scotland and others to engage in that meaningful process is quite challenging at the moment for us to do that. But I think if we were able to set out a really clear co-design process at the early stages, looking at those interdependencies. Certainly, if I think about, we were really welcoming of the fact that there was a pause on the decisions about children and justice until further work could be done about whether that was there. But the challenge is that we then design a process that looks at a national care service and children and justice become an add-on to that, rather than centrally ingrained at the early stages about what a national care service should look like if the decision is that they should be there. So I think for us, there's just some timing challenges around it, but it's not around the value base or the development of a national care service. Ultimately, it is just for us the order in which we do some of the work, I think.
Thank you. There's a couple of members that have supplementary questions, and it will be a supplementary question because we need to move through. So we've got Tess, first of all, if you can aim your question at once, someone in particular, Tess, and then I'll come to Sandesh Gohani. Tess.
Thank you, convener. Just got one question for Alison White, if I may. So, Alison, I noticed that you say co-design from before the legislation, not after it. But my question relates to, you've said that you are concerned that further integration could make adult social care a delayed discharge service. Could you go into further detail as to how that might happen?
I think... I suppose I should have, as a chief officer, I spend my life talking about delayed discharges in a way that it is a really critical issue. And it's a critical issue for a number of reasons, not just the impact that it has on hospital care and how we deliver more generally, but actually at the point that someone is fit for discharge, it is right that they are home and it is right that we support them in a meaningful way around that. We already know within adult services that often the issue that we get focused on is delayed discharges, so we get to spend less time talking about people with a learning disability, people with complex mental health issues, people in the justice system, people who have substance misuse issues, because the primary focus and the thing that we often end up focusing on, if we look at the MSG indicators that IJBs already need to focus on, it is predominantly focused on that hospital activity for older people and what it means for delayed discharge and unoccupied bed days. The concern for us in amongst some of this is that we do just end up being a focus about how we support that aspect of it, rather than actually looking at people holistically. And actually, if we, it shouldn't just be the focus there. If we get that preventative early intervention right, if we support care as well, we actually need to see that flow in the whole system and the importance of all aspects of that. And there is a challenge if adults end up being subsumed into a national care service without children, without justice, not knowing quite where mental health, learning disabilities fit with that. The social work aspect becomes just a purely transactional element of me being able to get somebody a package of care to get them out of hospital, rather than thinking of social work as that holistic advocacy-based, human rights-based approach that we're in amongst that. So that's not taking away from the fact that people who are fit for discharge do need to be home. I'm not in any way suggesting that that is not something that is a priority for us, but it shouldn't be a priority above all of the other aspects of care and support and the way that we work with people. And I think Social Work Scotland does have a concern about the potential transactional, that social work is just that bridge between someone having healthcare and someone having social care, and social work as a profession is so much more than that.
And what you say in terms of the co-design,
Tess, we really don't have time for multiple questions at this point. I'll come back to you. Sandesh.
Thank you, Kamina. Chris, you spoke about the GMS contract just in your opening remarks, and I see lots of parallels with the GP contract and the National Care Service with centralisation, a policy memorandum that was full of aspiration and not fulfilled, and a second MOU was then created, issues with Highland and rural areas with the contract. So detail and delivery is obviously key. The National Care Service is far bigger than the GP contract, which didn't go well. Do you have any concerns that with GP being rolled into the National Care Service, that it will have a negative impact on primary care?
There's certainly many aspects of the GP contract that have brought progress and that have brought new parts of the workforce into and around general practice. And part of the importance of that is that we have a shortage of GPs. And I suppose part of the design element of this may be to consider where the shortages are. Coming back to the delayed discharge point, we want to have a community pool. You know, we want there to be support there ready and waiting for when people have finished the treatment that they need in hospital. Otherwise, we run the risk that there's parts of the system doing things that they are not intended to or set up for doing. And the as you say, the processes that don't play out sort of properly, especially with areas of the country that look and feel very different. I do think, when we talk about consistency, we want sort of a good consistency, and I believe we do very much want person focused care. And I think when we're trying to design things, when we start that process of design, things can happen in just within a short couple of years, and we see a pandemic come along that changes so many perspectives and changes much of the practice that we are used to doing. Alison mentioned that the disruption and that there are certain forms of disruption that are helpful. There are certain times where disruption is helpful. The recruitment and retention issues that we face in general practice, in wide broader health, in social care, they're very much a limiting factor. And so coming back to your question, I would very hope we don't design a solution that we can't staff or that we don't have the infrastructure to deliver. But I do, in terms of the ethos of the bill, in terms of the human rights approach, I think if we absolutely need to embrace that, and then it's the practicalities of what does our workforce look like in different parts of the country, what are good arrangements that we can build on, and can we make sure that the links to these various other agencies that improve people's lives, can we maintain the right links and not disrupt the things that are quietly working away in favour of our citizens.
Okay, thank you. I've noticed that Alison Keir wanted to come back in. I imagine it's around what was mentioned in response to Tess White. So I'm happy to bring you in now, Alison, before we move on.
Yeah, thank you. It was just to further to what Alison White said around transnational relationships and also to consider the need for consideration of the social determinants of health. So actually, unless we think on a longer term basis around the social determinants that keep us well, so a good home, good relationships and good occupations in our lives, we will not change that trajectory of people who end up in hospital and in part become our delayed discharges. So we also need to think differently about where we support people in the system.
Thank you. We move on to questions around community health, led by Paul Kane.
Thank you very much, convener. I'm keen, I think, to understand more about the approach to kind of community health services and where they should sit within the structure. And I appreciate it's difficult at this stage, again, in the framework to fully understand and discuss that. But I suppose as an opener, I wonder, should responsibility for community health services sit with health boards or with the new proposed care boards? And I'll maybe start with Nick Morris, if that's possible.
OK, thank you very much. Again, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
I guess my answer to that is I think they should remain with health boards. I don't believe they should go to the potential new care boards. And there's some understanding of that, which I think we need to get across here. There's a potential, if we're not careful, that the CE care boards are seen as a logical extension of IJBs. And in reality, it's the health and social care partnerships that have developed the integration at local level. The IJBs have not developed much integration. In fact, when the Audit Scotland did its report, the examples of good practice were merely the fact that the IJBs weren't shouting at each other, seemed to be the good example. So the IJBs, whilst they might be seen as a good construct, some of the governance issues around IJBs are not helpful to both health or social care, but the health and social care partnerships are. And I think there's plenty of evidence that has emerged through the development of community services, integration of mental health care, for example, where you can demonstrate significant advances in integration of healthcare across health and social care services, where you have co-located members of staff working closely with primary care and GP services, staff who understand the relationship between themselves and the acute hospital when people present with specific acute needs, and they're able to make sure that care pathway works for people. And the greatest risk, I think, going forward, which is why I think I support my colleagues, and we've got to do a lot of this design work in advance before we get to legislation, I think the greatest risk is that we create a further fracture in the health and social care system by creating a care board relative to what we currently have, which is health and social care partnerships. Now, the other risk with care boards is that the current guidance within the framework bill leads to a conclusion that no staff will be employed through the care board. Certainly no healthcare staff will be transferred to the care board, but the care board will be responsible for the development of provision arrangements and the planning and commissioning of the services. And we need to work out who's then accountable for the delivery of those services, both at an organisational level and at a private level, at an individual practitioner level. So all our staff, OTs, I'm sure Alison will support me, social workers, GPs, require an understanding of their professional accountability systems and clinical governance arrangements, and they will be completely fractured by an arrangement that puts a care board in place as described by the framework. Clearly, not much evidence or detail there yet, but that's where it seems to be implying the issue. I was going to try and come in on some of the earlier conversations as well when we were talking about care boards, because the process to date has not really seen healthcare as a significant stakeholder. We were not involved as a stakeholder in the initial consultation process as a formally acknowledged stakeholder, and yet one third of the NHS funding potentially gets transferred into this new arrangement if it goes the way the framework arrangements suggest. And that has a major implication on the NHS. And we need to work closely with our colleagues in social work, in COSLA, in the other organisations, on a co-design process built around Delphi model processes, which will get us, I believe, to a significant consensus on the design going forward. But I don't think the bill as structured at the moment gets us there.
And Patricia Cassidy wants to come in on your question, Paul.
First of all, just to point out that integration joint boards currently have, under the Public Bodies Act, the responsibility for strategic planning and the budgets for community health services, and indeed they are operationally managed within the health and social care partnerships. It's really critical that we're taking a whole system approach when we're looking at the care journeys and the health journeys of individuals, and that we smooth out any of those bumps and gaps between those services. In relation to the potential for the boards to not have operational management of that integrated multidisciplinary team, that has been real win-win within the partnerships, that we've been able to bring these staff together, to co-locate them, to manage them together alongside a matrix management with their professional accountability up through to the Chief Social Work Officer, Nurse Director, Allied Health Professional, Professional Lead, etc. So that there are models that are already working in that regard. But from the Chief Officer's perspective, we really feel it is quite critical that we are able to bring staff together. It is a potential issue that we would have staff groups who are on different terms and conditions. There's issues around parity of esteem, equality, etc., which is one of the challenges currently. But within the bill as it stands at the moment, there are unanswered questions in relation to what the detail of that will mean. There is an opportunity to look at that wider public sector reform and actually where could these new care boards sit within that broader public sector, and what would be the arrangements in terms of the organisational operational managements, but also the way that we work with and employ staff. Thank you.
Paul? Thank you for both of those responses. I suppose there's a culture and structure thing here, I think, in terms of the structures around care boards. But I suppose the culture that's embedded through HSEPs and some of that integration work. But I wonder if I can ask Alison, just on that point about potential staff transfer. We had COSLA last week, who are obviously very concerned about the local government space and in terms of what might happen to local government staff, and obviously representing social workers. Really just to try and get a sense from you, Alison, about what are the anxieties for the social work profession, I think, in this space, about what their future might look like.
I think there's a huge level of uncertainty. I mean, obviously, with the framework bill, some of the questions that people might have aren't answered at this stage and would come through a co-design process, but I think it does cause a huge level of anxiety. I think, and Patricia highlighted the fact that across the partnerships that we already have, there is a range of difference. So we know that whatever comes out of this, there will be change somewhere. So in some areas, children's services are in some areas, children's services is out. Whatever the decision is about where children sit, there will be changes that happen somewhere across Scotland. So there is a level of anxiety. For some people, they are welcoming a level of change. They think this is an opportunity. They maybe don't feel that they've been as protected and as valued, and there's an opportunity within a national care service to really have a strong voice for social work and social care. But at the same time, I think there's that we're already struggling to fill vacancies, particularly within social work, both at frontline levels, team lead levels, and some of the senior management roles. And I think we also have an area where there are people who are close to retirement who are thinking that they're not wanting yet another structural and organisational change. So there's a real sense that we might lose a level of experience as part of this restructure. Now, people might be saying that and then won't move at that point in time, but recruitment is difficult at this point in time, and any level of uncertainty when recruitment is difficult can be challenging. There are opportunities within this, though, I suppose, in terms of some of the fair work policies, and actually as we go through that process for discussion about what that means and how we give that parity and how we support across the piece. And I suppose it's also worth mentioning that there are differences in different areas, so what suits for Edinburgh and Glasgow doesn't suit for our colleagues in more rural areas, who are already experiencing probably even more significant challenges than those of us who are in more urban areas that are offering that support. So it is a bit of a mix, but there are real concerns from a staffing perspective about what this might mean for continuity at this point.
I'm going to bring in Alison Keir, who wanted to come in, and then I'll move on to your colleagues, Paul. Alison.
Thank you. Thank you. The terms and conditions issue is a very big issue for occupational therapists. So we often come into integrated teams from a health background or from a social work background. So we're on different terms and conditions, different pay scales, different holidays, but we're sitting together in integrated teams doing the same job. So the bill doesn't give us any opportunity to explore how we make this more equitable going forwards. And what makes it work just now is goodwill of staff. So staff have worked really hard to get over this and make their teams work. But fundamentally, their T's and C's are different. And I think longer term, that presents a bigger issue if we don't challenge it.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Just listening to everybody here, it's really interesting that, you know, my understanding of this bill is that it's a framework bill to create a service that's more integrated. There's fair work, there's human rights, there's improvements in quality and equity of service. The Feely report, which I've got his recommendations in front of me, lays out a case for the creation of a national care service. And one of the recommendations is that the service's driving focus should be improvements in the consistency, quality and equity of care and support experience by service users, their families and carers, and improvements in the conditions of employment, training and development of the workforce. So there's quite a lot even in that single recommendation. And, you know, my understanding is this is about people with lived experience, people that need to have their care to prevent hospital admission, to not just deal with delayed discharge. It's not going to be a delayed discharge bill. So I'm trying to get my head around how do we support the co-production, the co-creation, the innovation, because the framework bill is supposed to set out what the further statutory instruments will come after that based on people's working together, whether they're service users, whether they're service providers, whether they're NHS leads, whether they're other people involved. So I'd be interested in comments around what Derek Feely's number 20 recommendation for the case for the National Care Service is. I see Nick has his hand up, Convener.
Nick.
I don't think there's any doubt amongst all the stakeholders that we applaud the principles and the aspiration of Derek Feely's report and the extension of that into the National Care Service consultation process. I think we would agree that there are significant improvements needed to be made on the integration of services at local level in order to meet the needs of people with lived experiences. I still think we meet the needs of significant numbers of those people well, but clearly there are lessons to be learned about some of the people that we meet the care less of. I think the reason why we're asking now for significant design work ahead of a bill is for two reasons. One is that the framework bill by default will make us look at the issues that are in the framework bill, and the framework bill refers to structures. So it diverts people's attention into conversations about structures, which at this point are not particularly helpful. They divert us from the task at hand, which is the immediate pressures we've got, both in health and social care. So that's a concern. But there is a need to address the issues of integration going forward. So we can't always put off, because of the pressures we've got now, the needs we need to do in the future. But the other key issue for me is that the most significant improvement we make for people with significant problems in health and social care is the design of work at MDT level, multidisciplinary team level, at locality level. I'm a psychiatric nurse by background. I spent 30 years of my 40 years NHS career working in integrated health and social care systems, social care as well as health. And the most significant things we need to do at the moment is develop those integrated mental health and community teams and GP primary care teams at local level, understanding the voice of local communities and how they respond to them, identification of clients rather than waiting for referrals so that we're more proactive in our understanding those people at need. We have some clients who will have very short interventions. They can come into the service and they go away. But the most of the lived experience concerns that are being expressed to us are from those people who have multiple issues. And their concerns are about being passed around from department to department, multiple assessments, etc. The only way you're going to tackle that is by having integrated, co-located teams at local level that understand their local community populations, can understand who are the individuals who are in need of care and make sure they remain captured within the care system to be supported rather than discharge, re-referred, discharge, re-referred, discharge, re-referred. Now, all that work needs to take place in order to make sure we have integrated health and social care services. That will lead to a fantastic NCS future aspiration going forward. But we need the structural design to follow and understanding what it is we need to deliver at a local level for people. So, and picking up what Alison Kerr said earlier, we need to understand the outputs that we're trying to deliver, the outcomes for individuals, and what the local requirements are of performance from an individual person's perspective. Are we meeting their expectations? And then aggregate that up to a national performance framework that impacts on both health and social care and takes us away from some of the focus on things like A&E waiting times, which are important but aren't going to get us through into a healthier Scottish population. They'll deal with the people who are ill, but we need to deal with the healthy Scottish population. So I think we need to start focusing now on an integrated health and social care performance framework that aggregates up from what individuals required to have for them in terms of preventative care and coordinated care within local multidisciplinary teams.
On to a question from Stephanie Callaghan. One question.
Thank you very much, Convener. My question's for Patricia Cassidy. I'm wondering, Patricia, what co-design is already underway with social work and social care staff, and is that presenting opportunities for social workers, for example, to really better apply their own expertise and going forward? Thanks.
Thank you. Perhaps I'll speak on local practice in Falkirk and NHS Forth Valley. So we have redesigned a number of our key services in partnership with people who use our services, with their families, their carers, and also with our service providers, if that's appropriate. So we've undertaken quite significant redesign of our services for people with learning disability. 6-7 years ago, we offered 5 building-based day services, and we had people who'd been attending those services for sometimes 30 years, you know, being picked up by a bus in the morning, a range of activities, and dropped off home at night. So we had done a whole range of consultation. We used a third sector organisation to be the interface for us with our social work staff. And we did about 14 months of consultation, looking at what actually was important for people, what they would like to do. And that then formed the basis of a collaborative piece of work, redesigning our services. We didn't withdraw our services. We changed the way we delivered services. We rechanged our staff to deliver much more community-based support and community-based services, commissioning new providers to come into the area, provide a range of social, leisure, training, and educational opportunities, also doing more concentrated work with individuals to help them become more independent, travelling by bus, accessing mainstream services, etc. So that was something which was quite challenging for the council at the time, to do that level of change, and our local elected members were quite concerned that there may be quite significant backlash in the community. But the work that we did in the co-design and the continual feedback loops into the consultation groups and the stakeholders was such that we didn't have even a murmur of dissent in the community. We transformed the service, we reduced our service down to two-day services, which became hubs for some people to come in and out and access support, or for people with more complex needs, had a much wider range of services. And in fact, the council had a couple of £1 million set aside in the capital programme to re-roof one of the buildings, which we were then able to close. And the council agreed to our request to actually use that capital to invest in changing places toilets, because we didn't have the physical infrastructure in Falkirk. We had no changing places toilets there. And we've now got five, and we've got a spin-off from that group who are working in our communities, looking at where we've got another two or three to build and where they should be. And the families are absolutely at the heart of that co-design. That's just one simple example of how we've done that quite collaboratively. And we're at another phase now of looking again at the way we deliver those services. And we're working on that with Health Improvement Scotland, neighbourhood networks, our social work staff, our health service staff, to look at the next phase of that. So it's just one example of how coming at things differently, pulling in expertise externally, and really meaningfully listening and responding. The more we spoke to individuals and groups of people, the more they wanted to know, the more they wanted to contribute. And that's just a wee microcosm of the potential that we can do around co-design. Thanks.
We've a number of members wanting to come in. If I can ask them to be succinct and focused, because we only have half an hour left with our colleagues. So, James, first of all.
Thank you, convener. First of all, I was on a health and social care partnership and I was a councillor, and I saw the benefit of that joint working, although silo mentality was still very strong then. So I'm pleased to hear that things have improved in the IGBs. But I want to ask Alison Keir a question. This is a framework bill. So obviously you've all got an opportunity to sort of feed into what you would like to see, sort of co-design that. But you mentioned the specifics about different terms and conditions. Surely something like this would go some way to alleviate the problem of different terms and conditions between the staff and the two bodies as present.
And that was to Alison Keir.
Yeah, but it isn't clear in the bill that we will tackle the different staff from different agencies being on different terms and conditions. So my understanding is we end up with what we have just now. So we still have staff from health on one lot of T's and C's, and staff from social work, social care on different T's and C's, working together in the same team, doing the same job. But we haven't tackled that T's and C's problem.
You're at the very beginning of the process. But,
okay. Thank you, James.
This is the
absolutely
time.
Absolutely. Yeah. So it's important we do tackle it. Absolutely.
Thank you. And a question from Carol Mochan.
Hi. I think possibly Nick Morris might be able to answer this. I'm interested to know, does the Framework Bill give us enough information about some of the legislative stuff around adults with incapacity, you know, mental health issues, whether there's enough in the Framework Bill to help transition with that MAPA, those kind of things?
I don't think there's any evidence, detail in the bill at the point about that. I know that the design process has just launched a consultation document around mental health related to the NCS, and so we'll be keen to engage with that, but I think that only came out this week. So there's lots of potential within the design process to try and pick up the issues related to those significantly disadvantaged people, but I don't think the bill makes reference to that. And again, the reason that we have concerns about the Framework Bill is because it focuses at this point on some of the structural elements that they wish to eventually bring legislation to bring into place, and it's not allowing us to have the conversations about the design work at local level, or it's discouraging us from having those conversations which need to take place.
Okay. That's helpful, thank you.
We move on to talk about prevention and early intervention, and questions led by Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think I'll come to Alison White first with this question, if that's okay. How can the bill help to deliver the recommendations of the Christie Commission? Obviously, we've heard concerns this morning about the lack of detail regarding prevention and early intervention. What would panel members like to see included going forward?
I think part of one of the concerns that we have, I suppose, is around and what we would want to see, I suppose, moving ahead in amongst this. We've already got a real strength in terms of self-directed support legislation, in terms of how we have good conversations with people about how we look at choice and control, how we look at people's rights and responsibilities and amongst some of that. I'm not saying that that has rolled out in every area as fully as we would want it to at this point in time, but I think we have a framework legislation about how we work with people, about how we have good conversations, about how we work to support people at an earlier possible stage as we can. But I think there's some elements of this that we need to be getting into. So we've already referenced things like eligibility criteria and how we work with that, and I think what we've not touched on today is the financial memorandum and what that will look like. So all of these aspects come with a significant cost associated with it, of which hasn't been costed as yet. We haven't done that design work to work out what something new would look like, to work out how we would cost it. But often in the times of austerity and where there are budget cuts that are required to be taken, it's often those preventative and early intervention services that end up being the ones that are cut, because we end up needing to deliver for those really critical services and maintaining those at that point in time. But we all know and we all feel that that being able to invest in those earlier intervention and prevention services is the right thing to do, and actually create and prevents those crises over time in terms of where we are. So I think it's around us needing to do some of that design to fully understand what the costs of those aspirations are, because there's nothing within the Feely report that we wouldn't be wholeheartedly supportive of in terms of thinking that it is the right thing to do for the people that we support in our communities. But we do need to understand the cost implications of doing that and how we share the budget around to allow us to do that. If I may just very briefly touch back on the previous question about the protection issues, I don't think they're fully covered. And I think one aspect that's particularly missed within the bill as it stands at the moment is the role of Chief Social Work Officer. When we look at those legislative frameworks, there's a clear role for Chief Social Worker in amongst that. Now, while social workers mentioned, very rarely in the bill, or if at all, is the role of Chief Social Work Officer and that governance around ensuring that we're keeping people's rights safe in amongst that. And if we were looking at a whole scale shift of that responsibility to ministers as opposed to them sitting with local authorities, and the scale of legislative change that would be required to ensure that we maintain that safety, and particularly when we look at the bill in terms of the data sharing and the health and care record, actually we need to be really mindful that some of that data that will be stored from a social work perspective is very specifically in terms of that protection agenda, which is very different to the types of data that might be shared elsewhere. And we are engaged in those conversations, but I did just want to touch on that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. I had a meeting earlier this week with Alison Bavage about social work and within the NCS bill, and Alison used a very useful term to describe social workers of essentially the GPs of social care. And I'd be interested in your thoughts of how we make sure through this bill that social work is not continuing to deliver small things and gets back to that holistic cross well-being view that social workers would like to see it get back to, and that sort of restoration of the profession. Obviously it's heavily legislative based, and this is another piece of legislation coming in to add to that spectrum as well. So just your thoughts on how we make sure we get back to that cross issue look, rather than delivering pieces of justice and then investigative work and other things, and looking at the whole wellbeing piece.
I don't know if you've seen the Setting the Bar report that Social Work Scotland had undertaken, and as part of that report, I think it was very much looking at the workforce issues that we're experiencing and was surveying all of our staff around some of the challenges. But as part of that report, we really mapped out some of the legislative issues that social work had needed to pick up over the last period, and it wasn't quite all of them, but it was a really significant shift and change that we're needing to deliver without properly having reinvestment within that, both in terms of the skill set that we're looking and how we deliver. And there are challenges at times within social work that some of the pieces of legislation don't sit as comfortably with one another, and that there are you almost choose which bit of legislation fits best for the individuals that you're working within. But I think to some extent the National Care Service and the opportunity that the development of the bill and the role of social work and social care, but social work in particular and amongst this, is a real opportunity for us. And as I say, we are not against the development of the National Care Service and the conversations that we can have. We think social work have that skill set and that real strength to really be able to drive forward much of what we've seen within Feely's report sits within that training and development that we all have had as social workers in terms of how we drive that forward. Not to say that other professions haven't seen us. I'm in a mixed profession group at this point in time. I'm not suggesting it is just us that have that. But I think there is something in that core value set and how we work with people and those good conversations that actually the Feely report really resonated with most of us in terms of what we were wanting to do and how we were going to drive that forward. So if nothing else, the opportunity for the conversation and the role that social work can play is really welcomed by us.
Move on to some questions on this theme from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Chair. That was really great, Alison. I think that's dead helpful. And also the point on protections for chief social work officers, I think, was one that was really, really well made. And just to note that that can be heads of service and things as well. It's not always at the very, very top level there. But my question was kind of picking up on where Gillian's been going there as well. You know, we do have, for example, in my constituency, we've got Enable Scotland that use SDS and deliver personal assistant. So it's really about focusing on that individual, what it is that matters to them. And that has very much a wellbeing approach, and it has a preventative approach as well, rather than kind of picking up from a choice of services that happen to be available there. So really, really interested in this. And you mentioned about the costs associated with that. And I know that Enable have said, actually, it doesn't cost more most of the time for us. So I thought that was really quite interesting as well. But what I'm wondering probably mainly is, you know, what recommendations would you like to see us making in a report to actually make sure that we do have this kind of front and centre in the bill, that we do have this covered?
I mean, I think it's about it is about that co-design process. It is around making sure that we have that strong voice of people who use our services, people who are caring, but actually we need an equally strong voice for those people who are assessing and are delivering services. And amongst this, I think we understand different bits of the system, and I suppose to create something new, we need to understand all aspects of the system, not just a perception or a part of that system. And I think we're all thinking that something needs to change in the system. There's some fantastic bits of work out there. Patricia's mentioned some good areas of development. We could have those stories in each of the different areas, but we all also, I think, equally think there is more that we can do to develop those services. So I think it is around that co-design process, but giving us the time and the scope to do that properly and to make sure that we've got the right people involved. And I think to think about those interdependencies, this is such a whole-scale change. When I look at the plan of work for the NCS, there's something like 70 different work streams in amongst them, and there are clear interdependencies between all of them. And I think to ensure that we have that strong voice, and from our point, from Social Work Scotland and from the voice of our members in terms of social workers who are part of that, it's about making sure that we get the time to have those really good conversations in amongst that really begin to shape what we need in amongst some of this service redesign. But a really strong commitment that things need to go up. But there are some really strong pieces that are already in place. We've mentioned the self-directed support legislation. There's some really good, strong legislation that's already there that might not be fully embedded in all areas, but actually it is the right principles, the right framework, and it is around making sure that we make a success of some of those areas of work rather than losing some of those aspects, because those already have all of the principles we have about co-design and working well with people and individuals really getting to think about what matters to them and what's important in terms of their own outcomes.
Because there is that gap between this framework legislation, which will then set the course onto the secondary legislation. You mentioned 70 work streams. And the NCS, or National Care System, isn't expected to be delivered until the end of this Parliament. That is a fair amount of time for that process to happen, would you agree?
It is, and I suppose the only difference we have is that we would do the co-design prior to some of that set of legislation. But yes, it's not an unrealistic time frame for us to be doing some of that work, but it's the timing for us that we need. Okay.
Thank you. Right, I'm just looking at our next theme, which is about keeping things local, and questions led by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. You'll be pleased to hear that a lot of my questions have already been answered. There's been a lot on co-design already. But I suppose my focus is on, probably tying in neatly to what we've just been speaking about, frontline staff. They're very busy. We've talked about the challenges this morning, the pandemic, workload, etc. How can we make sure that frontline staff are frontline and centre of the co-design? How can we make sure they have the time to fully participate in what's happening? And we have just heard that there will be significant time, but how do we make sure they're at the front of that process? And I'd like to ask Dr. Williams.
I'd probably start by saying that initially in the consultation stages, a lot of our members, their headspace immediately went over to the threat that they might be absorbed, that the management of general practice might be absorbed into an organisation that hasn't got a long sort of established track record of managing general practice, and so I think that you might find that sort of behaviour unfolding in other professional groups that when you suggest that there's going to be a reorganisation, are people ready for that? Are professional groups already speaking and discussing about how can we best synergize our activities? Do we have the right groupings we've got different hubs, we've got co-locations of different services, different things, but I think we could do well to spend some effort and energy into working out how we maximise in general practice. One of the issues we encounter is that not having enough time and resource to be able to stop and reflect on just where we are at the moment. These systems that are continually changing round about us. Are we maximising those systems? And Dr. Gohani picked up on some of the issues earlier on about have we anticipated when we're going into these changes, have we got the IT models correctly? Are we going to find out that we're paying for software licenses for somebody to work in one specific place, and then actually it costs a lot more because we're asking one person to work in multiple GP surgeries? So I think there's lots of specifics that people will be able to tell us about, that we'll be able to work out how we can build a health and social care service that is better integrated in some of these fine bits of working where there's good economies of scale. And I think if we've got a process, so as well as the legislation I think once you've got the primary legislation, that then gives people certainty that they know what's happening. But I think giving people confidence that there's been a bit, it's enough mapping out of what things would look like or where things will need to move from if we're going to find new structures and teams that look slightly differently, or again with my OT colleagues, if you can explain to them, this will definitively solve a problem that's mentioned, I think you'll get you'll find a lot more buy-in, and once you can, I guess, remove some of the potential threats that these different professions are feeling, and they may be perceptions rather than real threats. If we can remove some of those, that would be welcome. And I think the history of that we've got in Scotland of being able to design person-centred services is a really strong one. But I think a little bit more the discussion in the background would really give that confidence.
We've got some other panellists want to come in on this. Alison Keir, and then I'll come to Patricia Cassidy. Alison.
Thank you. I think the time is also about getting the right people around the table, so we have time to hear each other's stories and lessons that we've learned. So for occupational therapists in Dumfries and Galloway, 65% of people who are discharged from hospital going through the reablement programme regain independence. So how do we share that as good practice so we can scale that up? And also, again, for occupational therapists from the RCOT, we know that OTs are 4% of the regulated health and care workforce, but address 35 to 45% of all referrals. So actually, we're not huge in number, but our outputs are significant. So how can we be part of that wider dialogue? So we're thinking about how we can all be part of a new future, and everybody has an equal voice around that table.
Thank you. And Patricia Casti.
This is one of the great opportunities with the National Care Services, actually, to reposition our whole health and care workforce in, you know, a value-based culture and actually recognition of the value of that workforce. I mean, there are a number of formal structures in place through our trade unions, our staff side, the professional bodies. We also have joint staff forums at integration joint board level where we bring together those representatives. But that all needs to be enriched and augmented with the voices of our frontline and other staff. They know their communities, they know their job, they can see where things could be improved and changed, they understand where some of the solution lies. And I would suggest also we need to be talking to our potential workforce, we need to be talking to our young people in schools and understanding what type of employment, what type of rewards and enjoyment and what's their motivation and how can we attract them into these professions and these positions, because we have significant workforce challenges. How do we then engineer in that we're growing a workforce and a workforce for the future? So there are a number of elements there, but critically we need to hear from staff at all levels and they need to be able to see what they've said reflected in what comes out through the legislation. Thanks.
Thank you. Evelyn?
Nick
Morris wants to come in.
Very important point around the question was about how do we engage our staff in the conversations about the development of the NGS, and I think it's fundamentally important that we have to. So there's two things. One is to remind everybody of the systems pressure we're currently under means actually most of our staff are struggling to get any reflective time at all, either in the healthcare system or social care system. They're working with the nose to the grindstone all the time. So there's an issue there about the current position. The convener described the fact we have, I think it's 3.5 years now, is it, for the end of this parliament to produce a bill. I think our constituencies would be saying could be very bit careful about pace, because I'd rather get it right than get pace. When the NHS was originally conceived in the 1930s, the original bill that created the NHS was 1938, the Emergency Hospitals Bill. It took 10 years to get to the actual NHS, and then it took to the end 1980s before we managed to integrate properly community services and GP family practitioner services, and even then we'd left social care services after that process into a different arrangement. So all those decades took a long time to get to even where we are now, and we'd rather build on where we're going than distract from it. And the last point raised is about the fact that we are currently in a recruitment problem. And I think people looking to join the health and social care practitioners workforce will want to have some understanding of what they're walking into. So at this point in time, I think it's really difficult for them to understand who's their accountable manager going to be, who's going to own them as a body. I think we need to be very careful about the constructed structures, because that potentially detracts from our ability to recruit at this point in time, because people will not know what actually they're signing up for.
Thank you. Evelyn, do you have an additional question, or am I able to move to Tess?
You can go to Tess.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Tess, wait.
Thank you, convener. Dr. Chris Williams, for the NCS risks taking power away from local decision makers. What impact do you expect this will have? Thank you.
Ooh, that's quite broad. I'll maybe start by answering from a general practice perspective. So general practice, generally, is set up as independent contractors. And we mentioned earlier there's primary care reform that is still unfinished business. So we've still got a lot to concentrate on in general practice. General practitioners have been on the health and social care partnerships, in terms of playing a positive part in trying to sort of help, sort of navigate these meetings of cultures. I think many of us sitting around the table here don't mind reorganisation as such. And I say, especially when that is generating a positive direction, where there are then sort of discussions that are enabled. And part of what we've just heard is that at the moment there's a lot of parts of the system that are too busy to be having a good, clear focus on some of the new design that's required, that we are, that people are trying to keep the ship afloat, there's a flotilla of ships out there that we're trying to keep afloat. I suppose coming back to what I was saying earlier, if you can provide our various professions with the confidence that there's enough thought going into the structures that are envisaged, and that these will be resourced, and that building elements of one part of the system won't rob other parts of the system, or won't coming back to the change that we've seen in general practice, I'd mentioned that bringing new parts of the workforce into general practice, into pharmacists, physiotherapists that weren't working there before, that have got new roles and that are doing fabulous new things, but there are a limited number of pharmacists and physiotherapists in our care system across Scotland. So we need to be careful in our workforce planning as to the pace that we think we can develop at, and again, which different parts of the system that we can simultaneously build and remodel and modernise.
Thank you. We are rapidly running out of time. We have about 10 minutes left in this session, so we'll go to our final theme, which is about rural areas and questions led by Sandesh Gahani.
Thank you. The Scottish Association of Social Work has raised concerns that the National Care Service proposals could exacerbate recruitment issues, and as Dr. Williams mentioned in his earlier answer to me about a system that we cannot staff. So, obviously, this is coming to Alison. Do you agree with the assessment, and if so, how would it exacerbate the issues?
I think we're already experiencing recruitment issues at this point in time, and I think certainly colleagues of mine that work within rural areas are very vocal about some of the challenges that they're experiencing. And in many cases, it's not just, and certainly in rurality kind of issues, it's not just the issues around the volume of staff that are there, but it's about having affordable housing. It's that broader community planning aspect about how we support our workforce and staff in those areas. It's not just the issue of attracting people to those posts. Certainly a colleague was highlighting that they'd been able to appoint someone, but the person ultimately withdrew, having spent 6 weeks trying to find accommodation in the area and not being able to find that. So it remains critical, whatever we do, that we work in that broader community planning environment to ensure that things like housing and the broader issues that we've got are available for people and amongst that. But we are experiencing those issues, and I think any level of increased uncertainty can add challenges in amongst that, those issues. It's not just rural areas that are experiencing those problems, and hopefully as we go through this process and we're looking at the Fair Work agenda, certainly that there are real opportunities in amongst this, and looking at what that might mean, what is a fair wage, how do we manage that. But there are significant differences between the urban and rural areas that we need to be mindful of in that planning stage.
Thank you. And rural and island communities face significantly different challenges to the rest of the country. What impact do you anticipate a one-size-fits-all approach of the National Care Service would have on these communities? If I can come to Nick Morris.
I think that the logical conclusion of the NCS at the moment would suggest to the island communities that they would have less control over the NHS elements of the care because it all going to a care board. I can't see the reason why you'd have a care board and an NHS structure on one of the islands at the same time. They just duplicate effort too much. So it's likely that the NHS planning and programmes of work would be planned from one of the mainland boards. We don't know how many mainland boards might be retained, but we'll assume they'll stay roughly the same as they are. But on the island communities, they're likely to only have a care board under the current arrangement. So I think that worries people about the degree to which they can then influence through their locality arrangements the structure of NHS care for their own population. So I think that's a concern. I think that does get replicated onto rural areas as well, where we have significant distance from the urban central belt. And in many ways, places like Dumfries and Galloway reflect the same needs of rural communities. And in D&G, we've created an integrated IJB that actually includes all our acute hospital services as well as our community services. And we would foresee that that model is something we'd like to retain because it gives some sovereignty over the degree of health and social care integration from primary care right through to potential referral into tertiary care. Now, some of the more populated urban areas of Glasgow and Lothian might be able to develop a different model, but I think we would see that some of the rural areas, Highland might want to get on this as well, might want to develop a model consistent with what is being considered for the islands, which is a single integrated health and social care system from primary care right through to secondary tertiary care.
And Dr. Williams, can I just ask, if we are looking at a fully integrated service, GP primary care in general needs to be part of that, but with the change happening with the IJBs, and if we're looking at particularly the lack of GPs and other primary care practitioners we have in Highlands and rural areas, does the National Care Service pose a risk here?
So I think if it destabilised, I think if it just in terms of what Nick was saying about the way that boards are configured differently if when they're different sizes, from a general practice perspective, it's difficult to know looking at the framework legislation. It is what we build through that legislation that's going to say either build confidence or, you know, give me other thoughts. But at the moment, in terms of how much resource we have for these different parts of the system, how we build on what we know about the changes that have occurred over the last couple of years, that's probably going to be more informative. So going back to there's terminology used earlier about admission prevention and how general practice plays its role in the advanced care planning perspective, the way that we're able to speak to people about to try and understand what their wishes are looking ahead. Those conversations happen in general practice lots, and if we can find better ways, more efficient ways to be able to feed that into the social care side of things, all the better. But coming back to the original premise, general practice is a busy place right at the moment. We have all sorts of workforce challenges, and there's lots of things that carry potential threat.
Just on that, I just want to pick up in terms of workforce challenges. Obviously, recruitment of GPs is an issue, but also recruitment of the ancillary staff that are currently provided as part of the GP contract. Do you think there's potential with the National Care Service to have a really a drive to recruit more people in to the sector, given the parity esteem between care and National Health Service? Because that's something that's come out in quite a lot of the consultation. Do you think there's no one solution to this, but do you think there's the potential? I mean, I'm happy to hear from anyone on this. Dr. Williams?
I suppose I might just reflect on our experience in general practice with when the new contract came in, we we didn't go for a big bang sort of overnight change. There was this iterative sort of multi-year approach to, and health boards were allowed to select their own priorities about which parts of the workforce they were intending to develop. And actually, a lot changed over that period. But there was throttling up in different parts. There was development, and there was some degree of reflection of what was working, which one of these new changes were bedding in well. We saw other things that we thought that the Scottish Ambulance Service were going to be providing lots, you know, a role, and actually ultimately that didn't then all pan out as expected, and our sort of efforts round about urgent care took different directions, again trying to sort of make arrangements for unscheduled care. So I think there is something to try and replicate in terms of if we can build different parts and pause and learn from what is being built, that might offer more comfort rather than some large overnight reorganisations.
Nick Morris.
I think there's every potential that the development of the NCS and a focus on social care and social work could increase the recruitment potential into those care areas if we recognise that social work is often not at the celebratory end of what goes right. They're often at the butt end of when things have gone wrong. And yet social work practitioners deliver tremendous things on a day-to-day basis nobody ever hears about. So I think it's an opportunity to bring into the public's perception what social work actually does, the positive contributions it makes to supporting and navigating people through into their communities and helping them to prosper and develop meaningful lives. Then there's an opportunity to enhance the role of social work and other social care practitioners. And if we tie that in with core and branch training programmes for people that might enter at certificate level, that might want to work up to degree level, that mean people can branch from social care or healthcare, whatever, that's a really strong opportunity out of the NCS developments as well.
Mm, thank you. And Alison.
Thank you very much, Nick. That was a very nice reference to all the social work. I think it links back to the fair work. I would agree. I think NCS has a real impact on this, but I suppose it's about making sure that we get it right in terms of that training, development, the opportunities and the fair work and pay and the terms and conditions. Probably less so for some of the social work staff, but I think particularly for social care, given that myriad of providers that we have out there, if we want to attract people in, we need to be able to see this as, yes, I think if we've got a parity of esteem in terms of that real focus, I think there's a real benefit for that. But it's not just about that parity of esteem. People still have bills to pay and mortgages to pay and everything else that goes in amongst
parity
that.
Parity full stop.
It's the parity full stop. It's not just the esteem that we need to be looking for.
Yeah. Thank you. That's very helpful. Final questions from Emma Harper.
Thank you. It's just basically to pick up on what Nick Morris said about it. You know, the National Health Service was created 70 plus years ago, and obviously it's a work in progress as well. You know, when we see what changes are happening, and I take on board what you're saying about the creation of a National Care Service needs to be done with consideration, and we need to do it carefully, and we need to make sure we get legislation right. But it brings me back to the beginning. This is a framework bill that we need to make sure there will be amendments probably for after the Stage 1 report and then when we take it forward. But I am just interested in how we bring everybody along with us, especially I think it's great that we should be singing the praises of social workers, and we can use this to value that work, and that could be done using national approaches to skills development, education and things like that as well. So just interested in your thoughts about that.
If you listen to the contributions we've made from ourselves, and including Patricia and Alison on screen as well, there's far more that we have collective understanding and agreement on than we have differences on. But we do have differences of opinion. And there's often a perception that social workers, medical staff, nursing staff, whatever, disagree with each other, and that's a wrong thing. But if you're going to get a multidisciplinary team to work well, you have to bring those different frames of reference into the conversations about patient care in order to do the right thing for the patient. So I think my concern about the framework legislation at the moment is that these conversations we're beginning to have and bring it onto this table now are the things we need to do in order to drive the future of the legislation. And it just feels that the framework legislation potentially gets in the way of doing that, because it's focusing it on conversations around structures, care boards, etc. We all aspire to having a national care service. I would agree with the First Minister as an initial aspiration to say we ought to have an NCS that builds on the and reflects on the significance of the NHS in 1948. That's a fantastic aspiration. But we need to understand what the NCS is, because it isn't going to be a coexistence of all healthcare systems like the NHS is. That's all provided by one organisation. Social care is provided by thousands of organisations. So it cannot be one body. It has to be multiple bodies. So the NCS is a structure for bringing those things together. And if we're not careful, we'll end up having conversations about governance, management, entities, all those sorts of things, before we've had the conversations about what actually unites us, which is the individuals on the ground who need all our contributions to support them. So I don't knock the NCS concept at all. We fully applaud it, and the aspirations of the Feely report as well. We just feel it has to be very carefully delivered. And these conversations, from grassroots up to senior leadership level, need to be bringing together what that consensus looks like so that we can inform the bill. So that's my position on that, I'm afraid.
Okay,
thank you. Thanks. And I'm bringing Alison Keir.
It's really important that we capture the value of allied health professionals in the National Care Service. We've talked a lot about doctors, nurses and social workers, but allied health professionals are absolutely key to that going forwards, as is rehabilitation. So how we enable people to have the skills to live their best lives and re-ablement to help people regain lost function. So rather than dependent on care, help people to regain function and to regain their independence and not need the support of a National Care Service. The rehab and EHPs as key to the future of a National Care Service. Thank you.
Thank you. We've reached the end of our time with our first panel. I want to thank each and every one of you for the time that you spent with us this morning. It's all been very helpful. We're going to suspend for a 10-minute break. And we now move on to our second evidence session, which is focusing on the independent review of adult social care, which was commissioned by the Scottish Government, and certain recommendations from which have been incorporated into the National Care Service Scotland Bill and the accompanying policy memorandum. And I welcome to the committee Derek Feely, the former chair of the Independent Review of Adult Social Care. And we'll move straight on to questions. Thank you for joining us, Derek. So the case for National Care Service formed quite a number of recommendations in the report. I just want to summarise for everyone watching, but accountability for social care support with Scottish ministers, a national care service would be established in statute. It would oversee local commissioning, procurement of all services, and there's a list of services that should come under its remit. And it should oversee social care provision at national levels with people whose needs are very highly complex. And the driving focus should be improvements in the consistency, quality and equity of care and support experienced by service users, their families and carers, as well as improvements in the conditions of employment, training and development of the workforce. Now, the bill before us, Mr. Feely, do you feel that the bill before us encapsulates those recommendations as it stands?
Yeah, I think it does. As you said, Chair, the kind of things that we hoped the National Care Service would be able to achieve was that clarification of accountability. One of the things I think that the pandemic taught us was that the public holds Scottish ministers accountable for what happens in social care. But the way in which the our system of social care support was set up did not provide ministers with all of the levers that they need to give effect to that accountability. It was difficult for people like yourselves in the Parliament to hold any individual or individuals to account. I certainly remember, as the Director General for Health and Social Care, being regularly in front of this committee and the Finance Committee around healthcare matters, but never around social care. And so a strengthening of those accountabilities seemed important to us. I think the bill captures that. The idea that we ought to be able to set some kind of national strategy, funding and direction for social care support, I think, is well captured in the bill. I think there are a number of areas where much will depend on not on how the National Care Service is established, but what it does. I think we would all expect the National Care Service to be interested in removing some of that variation, what people called the postcode lottery, to us as we discussed this issue with them, to pay some attention to portability of support packages across geographical boundaries, which is a challenge currently. You mentioned the importance of fair work in national terms and conditions. Some of that is difficult to codify in a bill and will depend very much on how the National Care Service operates, but I think in terms of a basic infrastructure on which we can hang some of those things, I didn't see anything that was particularly missing.
Okay, thank you. So you may be aware in previous sessions that we've had people representing their views that they think there's not enough detail in the bill. The approach that you took when you were doing the review is you worked with people that are accessing the current services as well, that people are working in the current services. And the proposal of the Scottish Government is to do a similar process of actually having a framework in place and then going to the stakeholders, various and many stakeholders, and involving them in a co-design process which will inform secondary legislation. Do you think that's the right approach?
Well, it's always important, I think, to involve people with a lived experience of social care support. We did that in our independent review, and again, that some of that was done in the consultation process that preceded the publication of the bill. So I'm never going to argue against further co-design with people with lived experience. Indeed, I'd like to see them as strongly represented as is humanly possible at every level of the National Care Service, including at the most senior levels. And I think there is a need now for some pace. It's 18 months, I think, or so since we published the report. As I have conversations with people in disabled persons organisations, for example, they'd like to see things moving. So I think there's going to be a balance here that needs to be struck between that essential co-design and keeping up the pace of the reform programme and process.
So that's contrary. What you're hearing is people want to see pace increase and maintained, yet there are some people, we've had people today as well as last week, calling for a pause. I mean, how does that square with what you're hearing from people?
I'm not sure. I wasn't able to listen to the evidence later, so I'm not sure who's calling for a pause. But the folks I'm hearing from are people who have lived experience, who are in disabled persons organisations, for example, who feel as if the creation of a National Care Service is the right thing to do. And I think they're anxious that some of the benefits begin to accrue. That's what I'm hearing from those people.
Thank you. Move on to questions from Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener. I wonder if I can just pick up on that point there about the framework bill and the way that this has come about. I wonder if some of the previous witnesses have said that the concern, I think, over a framework bill is that co-design could have happened prior to the publication of the bill, and the bill could have been co-designed, and then you would have probably a different discussion in many ways. I think in terms of those calling for a pause, I think that has been fairly well documented. I mean, Social Work Scotland, Unison, the Union, COSLA now. So I'm just keen to get your views, Mr. Feely, on should there have been a co-design process prior to the bill? And I don't think anyone disagrees with what you're saying about people want to see benefits and tangible benefits. So I wonder what your view is on, do we need more pace around other parts of your review? For example, the removal of charging for non-residential social care support, investing money now and not waiting for the delivery of a National Care Service potentially by the end of the Parliament in order to move the dial on those things.
Yes. I would suggest, at least, is that there has already been a fair amount of co-design in the conduct of the independent review. The vast majority of what you see in that report is our views and proposals that came from people with lived experience. I watched again this morning just to get myself ready for this, the short video that we produced to go along with the report. If members haven't watched that, I would recommend that you go back and watch it again. Because I think the language that people use there is definitely the language of co-design. There's a lady in it who says it's time to stop seeing disabled people as part of the problem and start seeing them as part of the solution. A good deal of co-design in the report itself, a lengthy and quite, I think, substantial consultation process that followed the publication of the report and that has led to the publication of the bill. So I'm not sure I would agree with any characterisation that there hasn't yet been any codicil. I think there has been some, and people might have different views about whether that's sufficient. But I think there has been pre-existing co-design, which has got us to this stage. I'm not suggesting for a second that we ought to stop that process. I think we should continue that process during the bill's progress through the parliamentary procedures. I think that needs to continue. I also think that once we get a National Care Service established, we need to switch, if you like, from co-design to co-production. Those voices need to continue to be elevated and amplified and central to the decisions that get made about how we allocate resources and what are the priorities of the National Care Service. Turning to your second point about the other things, I'm glad to hear your recognition that actually there were other things in our report apart from the creation of a National Care Service. We recommended a completely different way to think about social care support, a new narrative for social care support, which is something we could be changing right now without legislation. We recommended a whole host of changes to the commissioning process, to the implementation of things like self-directed support, to the support for unpaid carers. And again, that's something that's really encouraging to see in the bill. However, there are probably some things we could do right now without the legislative infrastructure that the bill provides. So, it'll be a matter for the Parliament about whether the work on the bill is paused. But I really do hope that we continue to make the changes that that people asked us make on their behalf.
Whatever I can. Thank you for that response, Mr. Feely. I appreciate that. And I think I appreciate absolutely what you say about co-design. I witnessed some of that myself in a previous role prior to becoming an MSP in terms of your review. But I just wonder, in terms of the bill as it stands as a framework bill, does it meet into your expectations and the expectations of those who have lived experience? I mean, my contention would be that what people want is detail and want to help co-design that detail and want to do that through the legislative process rather than after the fact. And this feels like a very structural bill rather than being about culture.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's very difficult to capture culture in a bill. And I think whenever anybody talks to me about culture, I refer to the work of Edgar Schein. Edgar Schein says the only way to change culture is to solve problems differently. And so I think we need to get outside of the bill and into what is a National Care Service going to do, how is it going to do it, how are people with lived experience going to be listened to in that process, how are we going to remove some of those variations that exist, how are we going to make sure that we can scale up and spread promising things in Scotland, of which there are many. That's how we'll change the culture. I don't think the bill is a good vehicle for changing culture. And I can't speak for the authors of the bill, but I'm pretty sure that was never their intent. The bill has to do what the bill has to do, which is create some kind of structure around which we can hand the creation of a National Care Service. The real work will start when we have a National Care Service, and it has to completely change the narrative about social care. It needs to make sure that all of the good stuff that exists in Scotland, like self-directed support, gets properly implemented. It needs to make sure that promising practice is available to everybody in Scotland, not just to people in pockets. And that's how we'll change the culture.
Thank you. We have Two questions from Tess White, who's also remote. Tess.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Feely, two questions, if I may. The bill has been described by the Convener of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, Kenneth Gibson, that the NCS bill is like using a sledgehammer to crack a nut. Could you comment on that, please? Thank you.
I'm not sure I'm well qualified to comment on that, to be honest with you. Some kind of bill is required in order to establish a National Care Service. I think the combined wisdom of the bill architects and the parliamentary process is how we ought to establish whether the bill is fit for purpose. I don't feel well qualified to make that judgment.
Tess?
Thank you. My second question, Convener, for me is, the Finance Committee again had serious concerns about the financial memorandum accompanying the bill. And what's your view of that? Thank you.
Well, I think we made a very deliberate decision as we were creating our report, which was to deal with financing as, if you like, a third order issue. So the first thing that was important to us, I think it's the case with the bill also, is what do people who rely on social care support need and want? That for me is the most important thing. Getting as deep an understanding as we can get about what people really need and want and how they would prefer to receive it. Second order question, what kind of system do we need to build in order to deliver on those people's aspirations? That's at least in part what the bill is trying to do. Third order question, how do we pay for that? And I think unless and until you do the work on gaining that deeper understanding and then being able to describe the system architecture that will get you that, it's probably too early to say anything definitive about finances. The finances will need to be sufficient in order to do those two things. I would be the first to admit that the job that we did in the independent review on financing was incomplete. We did the best we could in the time that we had available to try and identify things like unmet need, to try and identify what it would take to rebuild some of what had been lost through the pandemic. But it was very difficult for us to do things like fair pay, for example. And again, I'm not sure a financial memorandum to the bill is either a really great vehicle for being able to make some kind of assessment about what it would take to pay everybody in social care a fair wage.
Thank you.
So I guess that's a roundabout way of saying I think the financial memorandum is going to be difficult to create until we've got some kind of definitive answer, including to some of the questions that Mr. O'Kane wrote.
Thank you. We now want to ask questions around the human rights-based approach, led by Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you, Mr. Feely, for all your work so far and ongoing. I've heard some criticisms at times that the bill is not sufficiently focused on prevention and early intervention. There's not that much mention of it there, actually, in the bill itself and in the memorandum too. And I'm wondering whether that's something that you see as a bit of an issue, or actually do you feel as if that's part of the human rights approach to the bill, or is there something else that we should be doing there to put prevention and intervention more at the centre of the framework bill?
So I certainly think that the human rights approach should be absolutely central to everything that we do around the creation of the National Care Service and the ongoing improvement of social care support in Scotland. I think it's absolutely essential. I think in the principles that are outlined in the bill, there's something. And in the creation of a charter, again, there's something. I think these things can always be strengthened. I think, and I think human rights is one of those issues where, unless we are absolutely explicit about what we mean and what we want, then there are opportunities, I think, for that to be deprioritised. So, yeah, anything that the committee and the Parliament can do to strengthen the human rights, the explicit nature of the human rights requirements, I think would be welcome.
Thanks very much for that. Can I ask you as well, obviously, you know, human rights is absolutely at the centre of this. And that approach to social care to be delivered as well, quite often it seems to be at odds for some people with the constraints of kind of, you know, finite resources that we have there. I'm wondering, is that always true? Is that your experience of it? Or does that kind of investment in that approach actually mean, you know, that people aren't necessarily reaching crisis and stuff? Because I noticed that you'd said earlier on about that shift in focus to prevention and early intervention really strengthening the human rights approach to social care, and the fact that the informal community initiatives that are going on there and that can underlie things as well often mean that, you know, smaller issues are not grown into much bigger issues because that support's happening locally.
I think it would be wrong to assume that a human rights approach is more costly. If we think about some of the rights-based approaches, for example, like the panel approach, it doesn't really cost us anything to enable people to participate. There's no additional cost in enabling people to feel that someone is accountable for their human rights. Non-discrimination, I think, is likely to be less expensive than discriminating against people. Enabling people to do more for themselves and to live the independent lives that they want, I think probably on balance, likely to be less expensive than more expensive. That enablement point, I think, is connected to your the part of your question that was about prevention. So there are a few things during the course of the independent review that really kind of struck a chord with us and made us craft our recommendations in a particular kind of way. One was when a young man in a conversation we were having with a group of people with learning disabilities said to me, you know, you're thinking about this in entirely the wrong way. Social care support shouldn't be a safety net, it should be a springboard. And the second was when I spoke to a senior executive in one of the voluntary sector organisations, and they told me about this fantastic programme that they had developed that was about the early detection and early intervention in with people who had dementia. And they had been able to demonstrate that through that early intervention, they could delay people's admission into care homes. They could enable them to live at where they wanted to live, which was at home for most of them. And they could do that less expensive, in a less costly manner than admitting them earlier to a care. It was like the kind of perfect trilogy. And I said to him, well, that's fantastic. They had that in two or three local authority areas, I think. How are we going to get that scaled up? And he said, well, I'm going to have to go sell that to 32 local authorities. So I think one of the things that a National Care Service ought to be able to bring is an ability to identify those promising early interventions and bring them to full scale in a much more effective and rapid kind of way that would chime with people's expectations around their human rights. So I think there are some huge opportunities. I also think it's incredibly encouraging that we are having this conversation about human rights in Scotland. Because I read some of the research that your parliamentary colleagues had done. We did a fair bit of that international research ourselves as we were doing the review. There are very few places in the world that are having this conversation with a human rights focus. And again, I would commend the committee for doing that, and be encouraging to continue. I think that's what people I have spoken to who rely on social care support would want you to do.
Okay. Stephanie?
Just quite a short question. Thank you very much for that. I'm wondering, does the bill, as it's introduced then, do you think create the conditions for innovation? And is co-design and co-production well enough understood? Is it broadly enough understood right across health and social care?
I suspect the answer to that. I think you'd probably get as many definitions of innovation and co-design and co-production as people that you spoke to. So I think, I'm not absolutely sure that a bill is the right place to do this, but some kind of definition of what do we mean by co-design, co-production and innovation, I think in the explanatory notes or in the policy memorandum would be no bad thing, but whether you could define that in a bill, I'm not sure. For me, and what we meant when we talked about innovation in our report was innovation is, it's the bridge between an idea and implementation. Actually, we don't really need a lot more of creativity in Scotland. We don't really need a lot. There's plenty of ideas. Our challenge is turning those ideas into things that get implemented reliably. Self-directed support's a great example of that. It's a fantastic idea. Again, it's groundbreaking, it's world-leading, and if you, according to the report that was done by Self-Directed Support Scotland and the Alliance during the course of our independent review, it's implemented properly for about 50% of the people.
Okay. James Dornan,
what are the innovations that could get us to 100% is the question, I think. Sorry.
Apologies, I cut you off there. That's always the danger when you've got a remote participant. Carry on.
No, I had finished. It's always... Stephanie Callaghan asked me a question about innovation, which I'm really passionate about, and I probably spoke too long. So I apologise for that.
Can I bring in James Dornan?
Thank you, convener. Mr. Feely, I would suggest that in that example that you used to Stephanie, you just showed the benefits of centralisation. But could you maybe tell us what you think are potential risks associated with that, the centralisation of accountability?
So I think the main risks lie in a couple of areas. Firstly, that we separate the national structure and system of accountabilities too far away from individual needs, rights and preferences. And that's why in our report we recommended that we mitigate those risks by making sure that people with lived experience get a voice at every level of the architecture of the system. So one of the things that one of the things in the bill that I'm kind of somewhat nervous about is this idea that the national kind of National Care Service at the national level ought to be a part of government. We recommended very specifically that we ought to set up some kind of arm's length body to hold the National Care Service, and that arm's length body should have people with lived experience on it, should have unpaid carers on it, to make sure that we didn't have that separation of kind of central national level accountability and individual needs, rights and preferences. So I think that's the first risk that we would have to manage, but I think it's manageable. The second is Scotland's quite a diverse country in terms of rurality, in terms of the social determinants of health and well-being. We would need to make sure that a centralised national level entity paid due regard to those kind of things, but that's why in our report we recommended that integration joint boards or some kind of form of those ought to continue, and I'm assuming that's the intent in the bill around the care boards, is that they're able to capture some of those, that local diversity and factor them in. So with any kind of system design, you're going to have some risks. The risks of the current design is that it gives us what we get, which is enormous variation, a real challenge in doing anything that works at a national level.
Can I ask you? Sorry.
We just have to manage the risks.
Can I ask you? Yeah, I get that. In the process of this, your investigation into your report, come across a barrier to the idea of centralisation from dentists, and I don't mean that in a critical way, but likes of people who are doing the job just now, did you find that they were opposed to centralisation because they thought it might take some of the influence and power away from them, or it might damage the service?
It was, for a large part of the work that we did on the review, it was quite difficult to have those kind of conversations with people because folk were unsure at that stage about what a National Care Service was. And people had a different kind of sense about what it might be. So it wasn't until quite late in our review when we started to begin to pull our recommendations together and test some of the ideas that we could actually have some of those kind of conversations. It was no surprise to us that our recommendations were not universally well received. Because we were recommending changes to the status quo, and that's always difficult for them. The encouraging thing for us was how well supported the recommendations were by people who relied on social care support or folks that represented those people. And to be honest, Mr. Dornan, they were my primary audience. They were the people I was most interested in hearing from and in satisfying their requirements. So that was encouraging for us. The other thing I think that amplifies that a little bit is in the consultation around the recommendations, vast majority of people seem to be supportive of this as a direction of travel. So undoubtedly, there will be some people who fear the changes to the status quo and what that means for them. But I think our guiding principle should be, is this meeting the needs, rights and preferences of people who need social care support? What are they saying about what we're doing? And for the most part, as I said in my initial response to the convener, they remain committed to the idea of a national care service and to the other things, by and large, that we recommended in our report. And some of them are getting impatient and want us to get on with it.
Thank you. We have a question from Gillian Mackay.
Yes, thank you very much for that.
Thank you, James. Go to Gillian Mackay for a question and then to Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Feely. Obviously, in your work on the independent review of adult social care, you were taking evidence from service users, from those who work in social care and things around that. There are obviously a lot of work streams within this bill and within the co-design going forward. What would be your reflections on how we ensure that this is sustainable for people to be able to maintain giving their input and participating in that co-design, given the number of streams, so that we make sure that this is coherent across the piece and doesn't fatigue some of those voices and some of those really important stakeholders who maybe have small teams working behind them?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think we do need to make it as easy as possible for people to engage. What people told us during the course of the review was, you could boil it down just to four things, actually. They said to us, hear our voice and see us as a partner in all of this. So I think, you know, I think what we do too often with people is we bake something, we construct something, and then we say to them, what do you think of this? And that's, I think, not what the folk that we spoke to and today, that's not really what they want. They want to be engaged as an equal partner, and they want to have their voice heard. The second thing that was really important to people, I think, we'll need to take into account as we do this work in these various work streams that you described, is the conversation we were having earlier about human rights. Mm-hmm. So a basic human right is the right to participate. And so we need to give people that right and honour their human rights in that kind of way. The third thing that people asked us for was, can you just make this a bit easier for us, please? Ease my way into these discussions. Mm-hmm. And so anything that can be done around describing these changes in ways that are meaningful for people will help. In an odd kind of way, doing our review when we did it, which was right in the heart of pandemic during periods of lockdown, made it easier for people. Mm-hmm. It meant we could talk to many, many more people than I could ever have done if I'd been meeting them face to face. And it kind of democratised that process a little bit. So I suspect a lot of people spoke up or put things in the chat that maybe wouldn't have spoken up in a face-to-face meeting. So give people multiple ways to engage, I guess is what I'm suggesting. And then the fourth and final thing I've already mentioned, people want to be seen part of the solution and not part of the problem. So, and my experience is folk will come up with fantastic ideas if you just give them the chance to do that.
Thank you.
So there's something about the way in which we engage there that seems really important.
Thanks. And Emma, you have a question before we move on to the next theme.
Yep. Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Feely. Just a quick question about the National Care Service Charter that's part of the bill. In section 11 and 12, it talks about the creation of an NCS charter so that it's publicly available, and it also includes the monitoring of the charter or reviewing over 5 years. So I'd be interested in your thoughts about including a charter in the bill, specifically as it relates to the human rights approach and supporting people, especially in the receipt of care, because this is about embedding support for folk with lived experience, as I understand it.
Yeah. I'm very supportive of the Charter being in the bill. And as I said to one of your colleagues, if we could make that even more explicit about human rights approach, I think that would be a good thing. I think it's also an opportunity in the Charter to emphasise that that new narrative that we described in our report that talks about social care as being preventative and anticipatory, as being about relationships rather than transactions, as being about a vehicle for independent living rather than a place for services. So I think the idea of a charter is something I support, I would invite the committee to think about making it as explicit as we can possibly make it, so there's no wriggle room for people once we come to give life to what the Charter says.
Thanks.
Thank you. We're now going to ask questions around leadership and accountability, led by Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Feely. The independent review highlighted that really we should be moving towards accountability for social care to ministers instead of local authorities. And the Scottish public expect ministers to be accountable. And it was a reasonable expectation given the impact on national wellbeing. Can you outline for us the benefits to people, Scottish people, of this move?
So there are a number of things in our mind as we made that recommendation. The first was to try and give parity, if you like, between the National Care Service and the National Health Service, so that people would feel the same way about a National Care Service as they feel about the National Health Service. You know, we all, I think, appreciate how precious the NHS is to people. And we wanted them to feel the same way about a National Care Service. So there's something about that kind of parity of esteem between health and social care that was really important. The second, I think, was about the nature of those accountabilities to which you referred. Again, the context in which we were doing this was in the context of the pandemic. Social care, especially care homes, were on people's minds like almost never before. And the people who were being held to account for that, largely speaking, were Scottish ministers. And yet they didn't have the powers and the levers to fully exercise those accountabilities. They couldn't make directions. They couldn't be sure that what they thought were priorities for resource allocations were shared priorities. I think it was challenging for us to have the kind of parliamentary scrutiny that we'll be able to have in the future. Again, as I suggested earlier on, as accountable officer for the NHS budget, I've felt and actually welcomed that that level of scrutiny, but it doesn't exist in social care just now. And it ought to, I think. And I don't have to tell you this, but you are doing this on behalf of the people. I think that's another way in which this will strengthen accountability directly to members of the public through their elected representative in the Scottish Parliament. And it will give social care a profile that it hasn't had previously. And then I think the third thing that we wanted to see was a truly national strategy for social care, you know, a proper plan for social care that was informed by what the public told us they needed. And again, that's an opportunity that presents itself that we haven't had previously. And you know, I'm encouraged by what it says in the bill about the need to produce both national and local strategies.
Thanks, Mr. Feely. You said earlier that this is a groundbreaking, world-leading approach in the way that Scotland is looking at a national care service. Can you expand on that? Can you tell us why?
So I actually think that much of what is groundbreaking already exists. So, you know, self-directed support as a vehicle for social care support is as ambitious a thing as you'll see anywhere. The idea of, you know, Scotland's commitment to an independent living fund when some of the other countries in the UK were abandoning theirs. There's much in the existing system that is already groundbreaking. The problem we have is implementation. What we haven't been able to do historically is turn those groundbreaking ideas into something that every single citizen in Scotland could count on every time they had a need for social care support. And I think that, I think, is the missing ingredient that a national care service can help us to create. And if we could get some of those groundbreaking initiatives implemented at full national scale, then Scotland would be way beyond what other countries aspire to.
Paul Kane.
Thank you, convener. I think if I can just pick up on your response there to Evelyn Tweed around accountability and this Parliament holding, you know, being accountable for social care and the Minister being accountable. Would it be your view that social care currently isn't being held to account by elected members and councils and also by appointees of health boards who sit on IJBs appointed by Scottish ministers? Because I think the concern that Causal would take exception to that in terms of how councillors are connected to their communities and then hold social care accountable. But isn't the principle of local accountability at stake to some degree if we focus everything on this place?
So I think this is in part about what's the right balance between local and national accountability. I think it's also important to recognise that at least in our report, we envisaged a continued and very important role for local government as providers of care services, as partners in integration joint boards or in care boards, as the place where you would expect to see a lot of this innovation happen around residential care and prevention. So we envisaged a really important continued role for local government and therefore a continued need for local accountability. And we, as I said in my answer to Evelyn Tweedy, we we recommended that that social care ought to be seen in the same kind of way as healthcare, as something that had national accountabilities in Scotland. We wanted to be as clear as we possibly could about how those accountabilities would work. This felt important enough to us for our Scottish Parliament to be the primary place where those accountabilities would be exercised.
And we have a question from Tess White. Tess?
Ely, one of the questions that does remain unanswered comes from Reform Scotland, who said that they felt that there has been inadequate explanation about why simply removing local government from social care will lead to an improvement in delivery. They pointed out that the loss of local understanding and accountability, especially in the more rural areas, were highlighted as risks. The proposals, could you comment on that? Thank you.
So I think that the part of the responsibility of care boards, however they're constituted, will be to provide that local understanding of particular local needs. And I think as Paul O'Kane was alluding to, and I was attempting to respond, there will always be some kind of balance of local and national. I guess it's about finding the right point of balance, and that might well involve some kind of rethinking around how we constitute those relationships between national government and local government. But the main things that we saw in local delivery that we wanted to have a national care service resolve were around variation. So lots of variation in terms of those eligibility for care, whether they could get into the system or not, quite a lot of variability about whether they would be charged for services or not, quite a lot of variability around the nature of the provider organisations that were in that particular locality. And we saw an opportunity for a national approach to deal with some of that variation. Second thing we saw that people asked us about was portability. So why was it that they couldn't, that their care packages weren't portable if they had to move? They had to start the whole process again in a new locality. Couldn't we do something about that? Again, a national approach seems more likely to be able to resolve that issue than a local one. Third was this idea about could we better scale up and spread promising practice at a national level, or would that be better done with 32 delivery organisations? And again, our view was that you are more likely to get national application of promising practice through a national approach rather than through a localised one. But there's always a balance to be struck in these matters, and I think the challenge for us is to find the right balance.
Thank you. And we have a question from Sandesh. Sandesh Kahani.
Thank you, and hello, Derek Feely. The National Care Service, one of the interesting things you said was to set up an arm's length body. And I think it's clear the bill, having spoken to the Bills Unit, this will not happen. This isn't what's going to be happening here. And it's a £1.3 billion setup. Audit Scotland says this could be more. So as far as taking that money away from those local areas and local governments, do you feel that amount of money would be worthwhile in setting up the National Care Service and taking away the potential from places like local government to lose units, like they were saying, they might lose their lawyer unit because of the work that would be taken away from them?
So the main reason we recommended that the National Care Service got to have its own board of governance was to make sure that the voices of service users and unpaid carers would be heard around the decision-making table, around the kind of topmost decision-making table in the National Care Service. And if there are other ways to achieve that, then well, people should consider what those might be. But that was why, that was the underlying rationale, really, was to make sure that in making decisions about strategy for a National Care Service, for allocation of resources in the National Care Service, the voice of lived experience was represented in those discussions. In setting up any new organisation, there will inevitably be some changes to people's roles and functions. But it strikes me that there must be at least an opportunity for greater efficiency if we do things at a national level that ought to be done once at a national level. And also, as I said earlier about that question of balance, continue to do things locally that are better done locally. But I think some kind of proper and detailed analysis of what should we do once for Scotland and what should we continue to do in either at a health board or a local authority level, probably a useful thing to do at this stage.
Okay, we'll move on to questions from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Some questions about the workforce and fair work. It's included in the bill in the first section that the National Care Service is to be an exemplar in its approach to fair work for the people who work for it and on behalf, ensuring that they are recognised and valued for the critically important work they do. And in the previous session, we heard from Nick Morris talk about the National Care Service should allow the raising of a greater awareness of the work that social care staff and social workers do. So I'd be interested to hear in your comments about the fair work principles that are included in the bill and whether you think anything still needs to be added. Are there any gaps?
So again, I think this is a really important issue, and whether it was we spoke to in the course of our review, people would say to us, if you invest in one thing, invest in the workforce. And that came from service users and organisations representing them, as much came from the trade unions and others with an interest. Definitely I need to invest in the social care workforce. We identified a potential vehicle for fair work in a rethinking of the commissioning and procurement process. And in the introduction of an idea which actually came from one of the trade unions around this notion of ethical commissioning. I think the bill makes reference to fair pay. It makes reference to ethical commissioning. I think what we need to be sure to keep on the table is the connection between those two things. That we ought to use a redesigned process of commissioning and procurement as a vehicle for fair pay. And essentially what we would be saying to care providers is, if you are going to receive public money, here are a set of expectations that we have of you. And one of those would be that you pay a fair wage. A second might be that you're transparent about your company's profits. So there's a set of things that we set out in the report that we identified as potential conditions for ethical commissioning and procurement. So I think as long as Jade or Ella is explicit about the commitment to fairness, and B sees that ethical commissioning and procurement as a viable route for securing better pay for social care staff, I think that will be satisfactory.
Okay, just a final other wee question. For me, as a former clinical educator, I liked the national pathways, skills development, the ability to look at how we measure same quality of care that's being delivered, whether you're in Stranraer or Stornoway. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on establishing like national recognised career pathways so that we can focus on recruitment and retention, so that career development helps focus on valuing the staff and what care they're providing. So it'd be interesting to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think that's really important that people begin to see social care as a viable career. I think we also need greater certainty for staff that they can and will be released for continuing professional development. Sometimes it's a bit of a challenge for some of them, we have. And I also think that we need to be thinking now about new roles. I think one of the ways in which we could give effect to the underlying case in the independent review and in the bill for integration is at the point of service. And so thinking about from the end user's point of view about what do I really need here, and is it necessarily someone from healthcare and someone from social care, or is there some kind of hybrid integrated role that we might imagine? Which again, I think might well open up some of those career development opportunities to which you referred.
Okay, thank you.
Carol, you have questions on unpaid carers.
Thank you, convener. I think we can all agree that traditionally, as a group, who have been quite undervalued, but we really are recognising the great contribution that carers make. I'm wondering if you could give us a little bit of your feel for the bill as it's introduced, how that will support carers. Do you think there's sufficient information about how they can help in co-design? And then if we go on, how they can become full partners in any forward-going National Care Service?
So I welcome what's in the bill about, that was one of the things that unpaid carers asked us for. I do feel we need a different term for unpaid carer doesn't seem to do justice for me to what these people actually contribute to our system of social care support. However, I think that's what people are calling them, so maybe we should just park that issue and return to it. They're foundational to the way in which social care support works. I think it is no exaggeration to say that the system just would be swamped without them. And so anything that we can do to make it easier for them to continue to do the kind of stuff that they choose to do ought to be encouraged. Respite is one of those things. But they also, I think, were in the numerous conversations we had with unpaid carers and their representative bodies during the course of the review, they asked us for to They also asked us to be heard. And so we've got the kind of somewhat daft situation just now, I think, where unpaid carers can be part of integration joint boards, but they don't have voting rights. Well, we should just change that, I think. Why would an unpaid carer not be able to vote around the board table in the same kind of way as everybody else can? I think we should just make it as easy as we possibly can for people to continue to do the kind of things that they want to do. Again, there's a lot of really good stuff that's already available. So I think the introduction of carers' plans was a massive step forward. Again, the challenge there is implementation. Not every carer has a carer's plan, although they should. So I think the big challenge there is let's get that fully implemented at a national level and remove again some of that variation that currently exists. Whether you have a proper plan and support package is somewhat dependent on where you live.
Can I just come back with one more thing? Thanks very much for the information. In terms of carers being able to get breaks and support with breaks, do you think there's anything we need to add into the legislation to make sure that is a statutory responsibility?
I would need to look again at the bill. I did it earlier, but I can't remember exactly how explicit it already is in the current draft of the bill. But again, back to my, I guess, the same kind of approach as I referred to for human rights might apply here. Anything you can do in the passage of the bill to make that as explicit as it can possibly be, I think the unpaid carer community would welcome that.
Lovely, thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And some final questions on ethical commissioning, which we have spoken about a little bit, but from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yes, we've said quite a bit about ethical commissioning and procurement already. So my question just now is, could the recommendations of the review be made within the current model? And why didn't you consider alternatives such as public social partnerships or alliancing? Is this radical redesign of social care commissioning absolutely necessary?
I think that a redesign of commissioning is absolutely necessary. There were very few things that everybody we spoke to absolutely agreed on. But one thing was the existing system of commissioning and procurement is not working well for anybody. I think there are some things that can be done out with the bill. And there may well be some things that will need statutory underpinning to give them effect. We did make reference to other potential reforms, other ways like alliancing and public social partnerships. There's a fantastic publication which we drew on from one of the voluntary sector organisations, the CCPS, that outlines a whole range of possibilities around different ways to commission, which if you haven't read, I would recommend. We drew heavily on it for our report. The short and straightforward answer to your question is, do I believe radical redesign of commissioning is necessary? Is yes.
Thank you. So I note as well, Causeless submission to us talks about the bill failing to address the difficult issues that were set out in the independent review in adult social care about profit in the sector. And private sector provision accounting for 76% of care homes. So really been about profiteering rather than reinvestment. So should the reform on non-residential and residential care funding be included in the National Care Service Bill?
So one of the things I was looking for in the bill today when I was really looking at it was something specific about the oversight function that we recommended, the market oversight function that we recommended for the care inspectorate. So we recommended in our report that the care inspectorate's duties ought to be extended to enable them to conduct some financial oversight of the market. I feel kind of bad talking about social care as a market. It shouldn't be that way. However, and I couldn't find it in the bill. It may well exist, and I've just not found it. Or it might be that it's been determined that it doesn't need a statutory change. It might be able to be done administratively. I don't know. However, I still think it would be useful to strengthen the powers of the care inspectorate to examine the finances and the financial viability and conduct of care providers. Then what we were recommending was that ethical commissioning and procurement ought to be the vehicle that we used in order to get some greater transparency about profit. Because it's very difficult currently to get any kind of handle on exactly how much profit is being made and where it's going. And I think, given that this is, largely speaking, public money, we ought to be able to get that sort of information. And so that, again, that was part of this kind of new deal that we were trying to set out in the report, that in return for receipt of that public money, people would sign up to greater transparent chances as well as fair pay.
Thank you very much. That's all our questions. Derek Feely, I want to thank you very much for your time that you've spent with us this morning, and really tying the report and the bill together in terms of intention. It's been very, very helpful. That does conclude the public session of our meeting today. Our next meeting, the committee will continue our scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a further two evidence sessions, but that's it for today. Thank you.